Hello again. As you guys know, I am Eli, the computer guy, and today we're going to be talking about press and media relations for startups and tech events. So this has been an issue that has been coming up a lot over the years, and actually within the past month has come up a number of times, and it's a very curious issue to look at nowadays, especially for many of you guys who are going out there, and girls, and creating tech companies and tech events. So back in the old days, when companies dealt with media relations, most companies that ever had to deal with the media or the press basically were large enough that some kind of PR department or such was already in the company, right? So if you're going to have a big, large, massive company, you know, a company like Sony, a company like Microsoft, a company like Google or Facebook or any of that, as the company grows, you are simply going to get a PR department. It's just one of those things that you go down the checklist. You know, yes, we are a C corporation. Yes, we have, you know, this, that, and the other thing. You just go down the list. You and one of the things that you deal with is PR. But now in the modern world, we have startup companies who basically, with startup companies, what you have to realize about startup companies, essentially what a startup company is, really at the end of the day, for many of these startups, is that they are essentially their own independent department. Where they're trying to experiment with a business concept, and if they are successful, they will get bought out by a larger company, right? So a lot of the startups that you hear about, the question is always, how is the startup going to exit? Now, a lot of companies exit through an IPO, where they become a large corporation unto themselves, something like Facebook or Google, but most of these startups actually get bought out by other companies, if they're successful at all. At the low end of the spectrum, they're what are called acqui-hires, where basically large corporation, all they do is essentially pay enough for the startup company to be able to acquire the talent. But then others, you know, they're just full-fledged products that get purchased by these larger companies and get brought in. So like Yahoo bought Tumblr. You know, Tumblr was a small startup. Well, the issue is then for a lot of these startup companies is that they don't think about public relations because realistically, in a business sense, they're too small of an organizational unit for many of them to think about PR. Like things like press relations is just not something that they think about. On the other side, when we talk about things like tech events, one of the issues that's going on with tech events now is that tech events, many people have found, are very, very profitable. So even small, you know, regional or local tech events can bring in a lot of money. And so, curiously enough, a lot of companies that normally would not have really done events in the past are now doing events. So if you look at things like local, like webzines for technology, like so here in Seattle, there's something called GeekWire, and they do tech events. Back home, we had a webzine called Technically. They do tech events. And why they're doing that is, again, there is just so much money in it now, and it's something that they can do relatively easily. So I know when I was talking with the Technically folks, and I think they published this somewhere, so this isn't Batcave rules, but although they had all these webzines, so they had Technically Baltimore, so that was for the Baltimore, and they had Technically Philadelphia, and they had reporters and all that kind of stuff. The reality was events brought in something like 80% of their revenue, and their webzines and advertising on their webzines only brought in 10%. Of the revenue. But the issue is, right, in the old days, if you were an event company, again, as the event company grew, you know, if you're looking at like UBM, I think it's UBM who puts on things like Interop, or if you look at CES or any of these large scale events also, they would have their own press department to deal with the press simply because they were so large. Again, if you're going to have 10,000, 20,000, 100,000 people coming to your event, a press department is just something that's one of those things. It's just a check off on the list, right? Well, as these as smaller and smaller organizations start trying to do events to make money, one of the issues is that they don't think about how they are going to deal with the press. How are they going to deal with media? Now, the first question you may be thinking about is, okay, with these startup companies and with these tech events and all that kind of stuff, why do they need to think about the media? Why do they need to think about somebody like Eli, the computer guy? Why do they need to think about GeekWire? Why do they need to think about, you know, TechCrunch and all of that kind of stuff? And the reason that they need to think about that is it just simply comes down to advertising, right? Advertising costs money. So if you are going to be a tech company, if you're going to be a company of any sort, you are almost always going to have to advertise, right? You have to get eyeballs. You have to get people looking at your product to see whether or not they want to buy it. So if you go out there and you buy Google AdWords, or you buy Facebook ads, or you buy billboards, or you buy TV ads, whatever it is, that all costs money. If you can get media people coming to your event or using your products, that is advertising, because essentially what they're doing is they are advertising your product to their viewers or to their followers or such. And all the clicks that go through, then, you know, that's basically money that you don't have to pay for. So if you're doing things like, if you're going for Google AdWords and you're paying cost per click, you know, cost per click for companies is going to cost anywhere between $1 to $100. I actually do know companies that pay $100 per click, right? So if some kind of media does an article about a company, and that article, you know, gets 50 clicks or 100 clicks, that could be $50 or $100, or it could be $5,000 or $10,000 worth of value that the company didn't have to pay for. So the first thing is, for dealing with media, is basically, I mean, you're getting advertising. Essentially what media is, especially tech media, is all this is advertising. When you do a review of a Assininely device, that is advertising for Assininely. You know, when you do if I did a review for like a QNAP or for Axis or any of this other stuff, the reality is I have to talk about products. So if there is a product that's easy to get to, that's easy to get my hands on, and I start talking about that, that is in fact advertising, and so that's valuable. Beyond that though, in this modern world of media and press, you get weird people like me. So, right, I am not the normal media, I'm not the normal press. I am more of this personality. So I'm a YouTube personality, but now in this content creator world, there are Instagram personalities and Facebook personalities, and even Twitter personalities, right? There are these people that essentially are having a conversation. It's a one to many conversation, right? It's this weird thing, right? So it's much about reporting. Yes, there is a reporting aspect to what we do, but there's also just this conversational aspect to what we do, right? I sit down here, I sit in front of a camera, literally anywhere between 30 minutes to 2 hours a day, and I have to say a lot of words to you guys. And this is a really long conversation that we're having. One of the interesting thing with this really weird long conversation that us content creators, these personalities do, have, is that we have to drop in examples. We have to drop in names. We have to drop in explanations for the things that we are talking about, right? So whenever I am talking about a concept, it is much easier to talk about a concept if I can put it into context. And a way I can put things into context is to talk about specific products, right? So if we're talking about surveillance cameras, it gives a context for me to be talking about an Axis surveillance camera. So instead of saying like surveillance cameras in general, if I'm sitting here and I'm discussing surveillance cameras, I can say, well, take the Axis surveillance cameras that I did a review on about a year ago. Now you take one of those Axis surveillance cameras and you do X, Y, or Z. Well, the thing is, what I'm doing is I'm dropping names into this conversation that we're having that actually turn out to be awesome advertising, right? So again, like I said, I personally like Axis cameras. I really do. They don't pay me any money. I really like them. But by dropping these names into the conversation, it's a way that promotes these brands without it being in your face, right? If I have a big sponsorship banner that says Axis cameras, it's very easy to ignore that. You know, I don't want to see that banner. I'm just going to ignore that banner, right? When I go to Facebook and there's all those ads on the side, I literally just ignore them. It's really kind of cool how my brain works. My brain literally just does not even see the ads that are on the right-hand side of Facebook, right? Because whenever you see an ad, it's just really easy just to phase that out. On the other hand, when somebody's talking about a product just in discussion, the name of that product and everything that you're saying just slips into the brain because it's being presented to you in a conversation. It's not being presented to you like just forced down your throat. It's just presented, right? And so the good thing with having personalities like me talk about your product is because it just gets a drop in that conversation. I literally have 30 to 120 minutes of video that I have to fill every day. You know, I've got to fill it, and so I've got to fill it by talking. And so when I can drop in name, you know, when I talk about Ron and I talk about tech breakfast, every time I talk about tech breakfast, that is an advertisement for tech breakfast. How many times have you guys heard me talk about tech breakfast? Right? And you may not even realize that in a lot of ways that's an advertisement for tech breakfast, because I just drop it into the conversation, right? Just drop it in, and you may not even realize it, but most of you know about the Baltimore Tech Breakfast simply because it just gets dropped in whenever I just need a concept to throw in there, need a name to throw in there. So the reason that companies, you know, need to pay attention to media is, again, because we can give you free advertising, and we can give you a type of advertising that you just fundamentally can't pay for, right? You know, I still talk about OnSip. I haven't actually dealt with OnSip personally in about 2 years, but OnSip, it's a voiceover IP provider, but I just drop OnSip into some of the discussions that we have every once in a while because it fits. I know OnSip. I like the people that work for OnSip. I believe in OnSip's blah, blah, blah. And so whenever I'm looking for an example of hosted voiceover IP solution, I can go, oh, like OnSip. You know, it gets dropped in there. And that is a form of advertising that just, again, it's just part of the conversation, so people just hear it. So that's why media is important for companies, right? And that's why it is really invaluable. Again, if you go and you look at the advertising budgets for many companies, advertising budgets are really big. I mean, it is very expensive to do advertising. You know, I was a booth babe at Cisco Live like last year, and I was talking to the person, the CEO of the company I was a booth babe for, and I mean, it cost them $250,000 to be at Cisco Live. So it really is, like I said, because a lot of people, it's like, oh, they think, oh, tech media or whatever, that, you know, we're pompous, or we just think we're so important. But it really is. If you have a real following, that is really actually valuable for these companies. Now, the problem that I'm running into in the modern world, especially now that I'm me, right? So I'm almost at 600,000 subscribers right now. Obviously, I'm well known. So I reach out to a lot of companies now to try to interact with them. It's like, you know, I am big. I'm important enough. You should be interacting with me. And I want to go through some of the examples of the issues that I've been running into for you guys to be thinking about this for your own startup companies and how you plan to deal with the media and the press. One of the things that I'm so surprised about, that I'm so utterly shocked about, is that many of these companies simply have no media or press policy, right? You know, this isn't me being like snarky or mean because I dislike some of these media press policies. It's just how many people are kind of caught off guard whenever I come up to them. So like one of the issues that I've had, like going to trade shows and things, and this is one thing to think about. If you guys are gonna be, if you have a company, you're gonna be going to trade shows, one of the questions that you have to ask yourself and you should answer beforehand is how you're going to deal with press and media for trade shows. Again, one of the issues that I've had, which is really, really weird. So I go to these trade shows, I get my little media pass now, and when I go there, I have my little camera. And so many times I go up to film products, and then people don't know if I'm allowed to film the product or not. Right? So we are talking about a trade show. We're not talking about at the company. We're not talking about some weird little thing where the media is not supposed to show up. We're talking about a full-fledged trade show. And you don't know how many times I'll come up and as a media person, I have to ask whether or not I'm allowed to videotape things, which I find to be absolutely and utterly ridiculous. Again, you're at a trade show. This is not corporate espionage here. You're at a trade show. The product is sitting at your booth. Can I videotape it? But I've actually got to ask whether or not I can videotape it. And one of the things that I found is very funny at these trade shows is how many times the people that I'm talking to don't know. Right, so I'm at a trade show. Basically, I get paid for the amount of video that I create. So the more time I'm twiddling my thumbs, that's time I'm not creating video. And many of these companies, when I go up to film a product, you know, just take the B-roll or whatever, they literally don't know if I'm allowed to videotape it. So I spend so much wasted time sitting there twiddling my thumbs as the employees for these companies have to run back to a marketing person just to get the permission for whether or not I can videotape a product. Right, so one thing, again, and this is the important thing to understand, is that if you're going to be doing anything where you're going to be dealing with media or press, come up with a policy and then make sure everybody knows that policy, right? You know, if you're going to be at a trade show, people can either videotape your stuff or they can't videotape your stuff. It's pretty simple. You're going to be dealing with media. You're going to be dealing with the press. You know that. So not having a policy set up is just utterly like weird and ridiculous, right? So the first thing is like, is just to start thinking about this and make sure whatever your decision is, that decision is told to everybody who needs to know that. Again, like I say, if you're going to be doing a trade show, if you're going to be doing meetups, if you're going to be doing any kind of public events where press might show up, figure out what the hell your press policy is and then make sure everybody working there knows what it is. Because there is nothing that pisses off and annoys a press person more than literally sitting there twiddling your thumbs because you essentially want to advertise somebody's product, right? You know, if I'm sitting in a Fluke booth, because Fluke actually did mess around. I love Fluke. I absolutely love Fluke. But I was sitting there, and there was a couple of times with these Fluke booths where I'll go and I'll be like, okay, I would like to videotape these particular Fluke products. Can I do that? Well, and people like run off. And it's just, I'm sitting there going, oh my, you know, in the time that it's taking you to get me permission to simply video this particular product that I want to tell my people about, I could have videotaped this product and a couple more booths, right? There's nothing more annoying and tedious than just sitting there, okay, I have to wait for you to get permission, right? The next thing that you have to be thinking about, especially if you have things like products and you want people to review those products, is to think about whether or not the requirements you're asking for really make a lot of sense and whether people are going to agree to this. Right, so this is one issue I had, like with one startup company. It was curious. They did these fanless PCs, right? So these industrial fanless PCs, and I like the PCs a lot. They finally sent one over after we dealt with it. But one of the interesting things, right? And you have to think about, is the media person going to say yes to this? Does this make sense for the media person, right? So they contacted me. They said, we have these fanless PCs. We'd really like you to do a video, blah, blah, blah. I looked at their website. I said, yeah, okay, that looks good. I can do a couple of videos on fanless PCs. I plan to do videos anyway. This kind of fits into what I was already talking about. You know, it's good advertising for you. I get a free demo unit, so I can show that off on the video. Hey, right? So it goes through the whole process, the CEO, blah, 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 you know, the normal process, gets the agreement. Then I'm talking to people, and they're like, okay, so all we're going to need is your credit card. And I was like, what the hell do you mean you need my credit card? And I said, well, we're sending you a $1,700 unit. If we don't get it back, we're going to need to charge you for that. And I was like, no. And like, what? I'm like, no, I'm not giving you my credit card. Because one of the things you have to think about from the media person's perspective is $1,700 is a decent amount of money. Maybe if it's $25, maybe if it's $50. You know, I can lose $50 and I'm not going to cry about it. I lose $1,700, I'm going to cry about it. So one of the things to think about is like, why am I going to take on that responsibility? Why am I going to take on that liability? So you are sending me a product so I can create a video on the product and basically advertise that product to the people that consume my content. Why am I going to take on the risk of a $1,700 bill? Like, imagine anything could happen. Maybe the product gets stolen off of my doorstep. Maybe I ship the product out and for some reason it doesn't get back. Maybe 100 different things could happen. So for me as a content creator, why do I want to take that risk? What is in it for me to take a $1,700 risk? And really, there's almost no way that anything is worth a $1,700 risk. Maybe if I can get like a brand new iPhone in my hand 3 weeks before anybody else gets it, maybe that would be worth the risk. But you know, if somebody's just fanless PC, you know, I don't need a spare fanless PC sitting around my house. Right? So one of the things to be thinking about, you know, if you're selling products or any of these services or anything, is think about it. Is what you're asking reasonable for the media person, right? The media person is essentially giving you advertising. Does it make sense to ask for their credit card number for a $1,700 widget if something happens to it, right? Because again, like I say, for somebody like me, I will say, hells no, not no, but hell no, not no, but hell no, 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 right? So that is one of those things that you should be thinking about. And then with that, what helps you make the decision, because think about this, if you have a $1,700 product or a $2,000 product or a $5,000 product or a $500 product, basically you have to make the decision up front, is it okay with you if that product simply disappears? Because again, sometimes that happens, right? And so that is one thing that you need to be thinking about if you've only got 10 of these products for review. So a lot of companies, they manufacture a number of review units, even startup companies. Maybe it's 5, maybe it's 10, maybe it's 500. You only got a certain amount. So the first thing to be thinking about is, who do you really want talking about this product? Do you really want Eli the Computer Guy talking about this product? Or do you really want Linus, you know, Linus Tech Tips talking about the product, or Marque Brownlee or whatever talking about the product? Or, you know, who do you really want talking about the product? Because again, one of the issues that you run into with some of these startups is they're so excited to get like media that they have like these 5 items, and then they send the 5 items out to anybody. You know, somebody has like 10,000 subscribers. Does that make sense? So one of the things you need to be thinking about beforehand is, who do you really want to target? What media personalities do you want to target? And then trust them when you send them the product about whether or not you're going to get it back, or whether it just kind of disappears into the nethers, right? And that is one thing to think about, is since media people are basically giving you advertising. I mean, yes, we do get benefit because we can create content around the items that you provide, but realistically, who is getting the better value out of it? So, you know, a lot of times, again, like I say, if companies don't pay for content to be created, one of the ways that they can kind of support the content creator is simply by never getting around to sending a return shipping label, right? I have a lot of very expensive equipment back home on loan. Right? And I have it on loan because nobody has ever bothered to send me a return shipping label. They're like, yeah, we will send you a return shipping label. We will. So it's on loan. So we are not giving this to you, so you don't have to put it on your taxes. But yeah, it's a loan. All right, but a lot of companies are like, we're not going to give a content creator a $200 device. And it's like, well, but we're giving you advertising. So again, one way that some of these companies, you know, they just kind of grease the wheels a little bit, is just send the product and forget about the return label. All right, so that's one thing to think about. Now, so that's a product there. Now, one of the interesting things that comes up then is we start talking about tech events. So tech events, one of the things that you want at tech events is you want press and you want media, right? The more people that talk about an event, and the more people that talk about something going on at an event, the better it is, right? So these media events, these tech events, they are products unto themselves. Now, one of the issues that's come up though, and this is kind of curious, is that many of these tech events now are being put on by media organizations. So again, I was just at the GeekWire Summit here in Seattle. And so GeekWire is a webzine around technology, and so they put on the summit. Again, technically Baltimore, or the technically good folks back in the Baltimore area, they put on their own events. Well, something that can get overlooked, if a media company is putting on an event, sometimes they forget about the press. Right. And this was a curious thing. So, you know, coming to Seattle recently, I saw the GeekWire Summit was going on. And so I said, oh, that's interesting. So I went through and I scrolled through, and all I tried to do was look for the press email address, you know, press@GeekWireSummit or whatever.com, so that I could ask for a press pass. And an interesting thing, there was no email address for press. So one thing to be thinking about is, if you do want press to show up at your event or whatever it is, do you have a press point of contact? Again, remember, human beings are cowards. I believe that most human beings are cowards to the center of their beings. The more complicated you make anything, and the more questionable you make anything, the more likely it is they won't do it, right? So if you're holding an event and you don't have any press contacts, what that means to a lot of people is you don't want press at that event. Right? So I personally, me being me, you guys know I'm me, so I emailed both co-founders of GeekWire and said, hey, will you give me a press pass? And then they said, yes, we would be more than happy to give you a press pass, right? But think about that. How many people that do press wouldn't go to that? You know, they would go, oh, this is GeekWire Summit, it's being put on by GeekWire. Obviously, they don't want people like me to show up. So this is something to think about, like with Ron's Tech Breakfast. Does Ron's Tech Breakfast have a press point of contact? This is one of those things. Now, beyond that, you know, with normal companies now, one of the issues that we're running into is the question is, what is media, right? So back in the old days, 2005, It was pretty simple to know who media was, who the press was. If you worked for a newspaper, you were press. If you worked for a TV channel, you were press. If you worked for a radio station, you were press. And if you were like, you know, one of the few people who worked for something like CNET, you were press. Everybody else wasn't, right? It was a very big dividing line. Well, one of the interesting things now is, again, you have these personalities, you have this media, press, whatever the hell it is that we are, that don't fit into that standard definition of what press is. You know, we talk about these products, we analyze these products, we do a lot of the pressy type stuff, but we don't fit into a nice, neat category. And so one of the issues that I'm dealing with CES right now, right? So CES, I got the media pass last year, and so I just emailed them and was just asking for the press pass again. And the thing they said is, they said, oh, every year, you know, you have to redo the paperwork or whatever to get it. So just redo the paperwork and we'll see about getting the press pass. Well, one of the curious things, though, so I'm reading through, this is CES, you know, CES, technology, consumer electronics show, you know, this should be cutting edge of technology. And as I'm scrolling through for media credentials, one of the things that it says is, it's like YouTubers, Facebookers, Twitterers, and Instagrammers or whatever are not considered press. You must get a normal admission to CES. Now, this is one of those things that you want to be thinking about, especially if you're a major company, is what do you want to consider press? Because again, a lot of people are going to look at that. A lot of YouTubers will look at something like that and say, oh, well, they don't want me at that event. I'm not going to go. And so one of the things that you need to be thinking about is, you know, if you're going to have like a press office, what do you consider press? What is considered press now in 2015 that was not considered press in 2014? Again, this whole idea of media, press, all of that kind of stuff is a Pinterest, you know, is an Uber Pinterest user somebody you want. You know, if there's a Twitter account that has 500,000 followers, is that not media? Is that not press? Is that not somebody that you want there? Again, so right now I emailed the person and said, I think this is a little bit ridiculous, but I want to make sure. And so I'm going through the process to actually get the press pass now. I have to send them some stats and all that kind of stuff. But think about how many YouTubers will look at that and go, oh, well, I guess I'm not press for CES. And then you don't get the press. And again, you know, for somebody like me, again, 600,000 subscribers on YouTube with a highly niche demographic, realistically, I mean, how kind of asinine is it in 2015 that, you know, some hick at some local newspaper can get a press pass to CES that easily? And somebody with 600,000 followers in the technology niche has to jump through these hoops. That's one of those things to be thinking about. Now, the final example of the press pass I've been going through now, and something very weird and interesting, is, so one of the startup companies here in the Seattle area is called Chef. All right, so Chef deals with a type of technology that you guys need to know about. So there's Chef, and there's something, another company called Puppet that's actually out of Portland, Oregon. And basically, this is the automating of the modern infrastructure, right? So basically, this is software that allows you to automate the deployment of things like virtual machines and updates and configuration settings and all that kind of stuff. If you have 200 servers that you have to deal with, or 200 virtual servers or any of that kind of stuff, you can sit down at this product and be able to administer all of those servers. And just, it's absolutely amazing. You know, if you have 10 or 20 web servers that all need to get updated, you can just release the update and those 20 servers will be updated. You don't have to go touch them. You don't have to go put your hands on them. You don't have to SSH or remote desktop into them. You just send off the configurations, and it's an absolutely great thing. It's one of those products that I really want to tell you guys about, because it's, I'm not even going to say it's the future of tech, of IT, the world of IT. It really is the now of IT. It's one of those things where either you're deploying it now, or you will be deploying it, or you'll be a florist, right? It's a great thing. Well, it's interesting because they have an event coming up for 2 days, right? So it's just 2 days, and it's like this open spaces event where the idea is one of these unconference type things. So everybody gets together that deals with this product, and then they create seminars kind of like on the fly. So everybody's there at 8 o'clock in the morning, and they say, what do people want to know about? three people raise their hand and say, we want to know about this, 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 and this. And people are like, okay, everybody else want to learn about that? Fine. We're going to do a seminar on that. So it's really kind of nice. So it's this whole open space or event concept that I would like to know more about. I've never been to an unconference. And then it's this chef product, which again, is really like a really awesome product. It's one of those products that I want to tell you guys about. So I would like to be able to go to that event because especially with an event like that, not only can I learn more about the product, but I can learn more about how the product gets used in the real world. Because again, that's what you guys really need to know about. I mean, it's not about, as I tell you guys, it's not about a spec sheet. You know, here's all the features of the product. It's like, okay, you take the product and you actually put it into an environment with 2,000 servers. And what really happens, right? There's the features you buy and there's the features you can use, right? So an event like this would be really great because I could go in there, I could talk with people that are actually using the product, and then again, I can create videos about that. I can drop the name, I can drop the product into all these other videos I'm creating. Basically, it's a really good product, and it's a really good way for me basically to advertise a product to you guys who need to be using this, right? So basically, I go and it's like, you know, I'm not thinking anything about it. They're having an event. They're a pretty far along startup company. So I email them about getting a press pass. I see you guys are having this thing. I would like to come. How do I get a press pass? And again, it was interesting. For even a company that's pretty decent size at this point, it goes through this whole chain, right? Goes through this whole chain of people. It goes to this person, forwards it to this person, who carbon copies and forwards it to this person, right? And I'm just like, guys, can I get a press pass or not? And then it comes back, and their decision, and this is really interesting, right? And this is the kind of thing that kills the whole relationship with media and press. And so they come back and they say, well, we can't give you a press pass, but we can give you a 15% off discount. And so then I'm looking at that. That's the first part of it. I'm scratching my head. And so it's like, okay, so you want me to pay $425 and spend my time and energy to learn about your product so that I can advertise your product, right? So I'm going to take all this information and then I'm going to tell my folks about it. And my folks are the types that actually buy this, right? So it's not only that you're not going to pay me, because right, I've had a lot of sponsors over the years. There's a lot of people that pay me money to show up and do things. So it's not even that you're not going to pay me, but you think that I should pay you. Yeah, okay, that's not going to happen, right? And that's one thing to be thinking about, because again, a lot of these companies, they don't think about what is the value of media. Oh, this guy just wants a free pass to our event. And it's like, right? What is the SEO value of Chef? Right? I mean, I think Chef is a good product, and I think all of you guys should know about it. But if I'm going to spend money to go to an event, if I'm going to spend money for a ticket for an event, then that event or that product has to bring me back money, right? So spending money on CES makes a hell of a lot of sense for me, because even if I get a free press pass to CES, I still got to fly there and get the hotel, the room, and all that. It costs about $2,000 to go to CES. But it's CES. It's CES. You know, I do events on CES, they get views. I meet a lot of people. It is just, it's an amazing, even being, CES is the place to be. Again, like an Intel product or an Intel event, maybe I would pay for that. Because again, it's Intel or Microsoft, right? If I had to pay $1,000 for a ticket to go to a Microsoft event, you know, if that's about, you know, their latest server or their latest desktop operating system, there's a hell of a lot of SEO value there, right? If I come out of a Microsoft event and I can create 10 videos on the latest version of Windows, that's worth money to me. You know, I come out of a Chef event and I create 10 videos on Chef. What do you think the SEO of Chef is? It's just like, hey, like, okay, so I'm gonna spend money, and so that's the first thing to be thinking about, right? There's that thing. Well, our tickets are $500, right? And then the next thing that was weird with the media, and again, this is something for you guys to be thinking about how you deal with media, is then they said, and we want to make sure, being that you're media press, that we have an FDA here. And so basically they said they want people to be able to be open and honest about their experiences with Chef. And so it's like a friend disclosure agreement. Right, so if you ever hear of NDAs or non-disclosure agreements, non-disclosure agreements are agreements you sign whenever you're dealing with companies sometimes, you're dealing with products, which basically state that you will not talk about the product outside, right? So I have some company, I never deal with it because it's stupid to deal with, but you know, there's some companies, they'll show you a product and they say, well, or before they show you a product, they say, we need you to sign an NDA to state you're not going to talk about certain things. And basically, NDAs are generally stupid ideas, especially for people like in the media, because it really is a legal contract that states, if you talk about things that are presented to you here, we can sue the hell out of you. And again, it goes back to liability. Why in the name of the spaghetti monster do I ever want to put myself in any more liability than I have to, right? It's like, I can either learn about your product and put myself in liability, or I can create some content about Angry Birds. I think I'll go create content about Angry Birds, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, that's one non-disclosure agreement. So they have an FDA. It's like a friend disclosure agreement. So they want people to be able to open and honest and all that. So basically what they're saying is they don't want me like reporting or talking about inappropriate things, right? If people feel that something should be confidential, then it should be left confidential. Again, this is where it gets into the real world, the real modern world, and why that's a crock of crap. Because the problem is if you're a technology professional, you never want to agree to anything that could be left open to interpretation. Never, ever, ever agree to anything that can be left open to interpretation, right? If two people can look at the same words being said and have two different viewpoints on it, never agree to that, right? Because it will always get you into trouble at the end. Whatever you agree to should basically a five-year-old should be able to read it and understand exactly what it means. And so if you say something like an FDA, the question is what does that actually mean? Like if they said, listen, we have this event, you know, you can come as media or press, but make sure to leave out proper names. So, right, if you talk about how our product is used in an environment of 2,000 servers and how it succeeds or fails, all we're asking you to do is not use the name of the person and not use the name of the company. Right, again, that's an agreement I can understand. If they even said, you know, you can come here, but you really can't, again, like something like an NDA, that's not something I would agree to, that's something I can understand. The problem is, if you say something like FDA, friendship disclosure, friendly disclosure agreement, what does that mean? If you are at an event with 50 or 100 people and there is FDAs, especially if you're media, I have no idea what I can talk about. Because if I talk about proper names and proper companies, that may be wrong. If I talk about particular situations, especially in a small environment like Seattle, right? Because even if you don't use names, people may know exactly what you're talking about. You know, it's like, well, this one travel company with 10,000 servers is running into an issue, and they're all like, oh, that's Expedia, right? And so the problem is in that environment, is how do you know you're not going to get yourself in trouble? So with the whole chef thing, I was like, hells no. No. Okay, you want me to pay you to advertise and you have this weird FDA. That's okay, that's fine. I will just leave that alone. Now why that's important is because, again, we've got Chef here, there's also Puppet, there's also other tools coming online. And so the thing is whatever companies I have the best relationship with are the ones that I'm gonna talk about the most, right? All those names, all of that gets dumped into the content that I'm creating without even me really thinking about it. Again, as I say, you know, with like Tech Breakfast or any of those kind of things, right? And that's one of the things to be thinking about too. With media, especially with personality media, is you do have to realize that there is a bias involved. Again, as I will tell you guys, whenever I talk about a product, you should do your own research, right? I don't get sponsored by anybody anymore. Well, I get sponsored by Spiceworks is my only sponsor anymore. I don't get sponsored by anybody anymore, but I do have my own biases. Again, so the people that I have the best relationships with are the ones that I will treat the nicest in these conversations. You know, like with Ron. Like, Ron is my actual friend. I really like Ron. I really respect Ron. Ron puts on Tech Breakfast. So one of the things that I will say is that most of the snark or whatever that I may have for Tech Breakfast, I tell completely to Ron, right? I have the ability to talk about things or to not talk about things, right? right? When I create content, I can create it about whatever I want. So if I see an issue with Tech Breakfast, and I am friends with Ron, I have a relationship with Ron, it doesn't mean I actually have to create content about that, right? I can just go to Ron and say, you know what, I think that's kind of screwed up, and leave it at that, right? Because I have that relationship there. The more you have relationships with companies, especially with the media, the more they have the discretion to decide whether or not they're going to talk about you, right? You know, if I have a viewer that comes up to me and point blank, you know, during one of the Skype meetings or whatever, point blank is saying, listen, I'm going to spend $3,000 on XYZ, right? If you ask me point blank, I will give you my honest answer. But again, like I say, in all this other stuff, it's really easy just to gloss over things or have the discretion or have the bias because, like Ron, I don't want to piss Ron off, so we're just not going to talk about X, Y, or Z, right? Beyond that, you know, so like Ron is a friend. One of the things you also have to think about is things like with press passes. One of the nice things with press passes is if I get to go to an event for free, then there's no emotion about that event or with that product if I'm getting it for free if it doesn't work out how it's supposed to. Right? If I go to an event or I get a product and it's basically free to go and it really sucks, again, I have the discretion whether or not to talk about it. I personally don't have a lot vested into it because there's not a lot of money vested into it. So I may go there and be like, well, this was kind of horrible or this really stinks and I'm just not going to talk about it anymore. Right? Because there's no emotion there. On the other hand, if I actually pay for something, right? If I actually put down money for something, such as the Everywhere Else conference, right? So the Everywhere Else conference was a freaking disaster by this crappy-ass media company called Niblets, right? I flew all the way out to Memphis for the Everywhere Else conference, and that was just a flaming pile of horse crap. And you know why I say it's a flaming pile of horse crap? Because I paid my whole way to go to this flaming pile of horse crap. The CEO of it at the time was just a complete idiot. It was just beyond stupid. And the reason that I still get emotional about it is because I put a lot of money to go into it, right? I did not get a press pass. I did not get a free pass to go here. I put money, energy, the whole nine yards into it for basically this complete and utter mess. And so one of the things too to be thinking about with the press is that the more their emotions are tied to your product, the easier it is for things to go squirrely. So again, if you give free passes, all that kind of stuff, they may not talk nice about your product, but they may also decide not to skewer it either. Right? And so that's one of those things to be thinking about, like I say, with media and all that. If you force somebody to buy a product, you know, if I put out $1,000 for a new product, if I put out, you know, Oculus Rift is obviously not going to send me a free product, I don't think. Maybe if they do, but I don't think they will. But, you know, if I put $350 or $400 on the table to buy the new Oculus Rift, I'm going to tell you guys exactly how I feel. Because one of the issues I run into is I've spent money on it. Right? If I haven't spent money on something, I haven't invested into it, therefore I don't really need to create content about it. If I've spent money on a product, if I've spent money on an event, I have to create content about that event one way or the other, right? I've got to recoup my investment. So I can either recoup my investment by talking about wonderful things if it's a wonderful product, but if it's a piece of crap, I will hammer on how horrible that piece of crap is from now until I get bored, simply because I've got to create enough content about whatever that is to recoup the investment I made in buying the product or going to it, right? So that's some of those things to be thinking about with dealing with the media. So what I would say with you guys is, again, the big thing, if you're going to have a startup company, if you're going to be doing events, if you're going to be doing any of that, the big thing I want you guys to be thinking about is simply ask yourself, how do you deal with the media? How do you deal with the press, right? Because the big issue that I see right now is so many of these companies, they don't even know. Even if I was from the New York Times, they still wouldn't know what the hell to do with me. Again, like I say, with that whole chef thing, it was just this absurd email chain. Like, da 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 da. And it's like, seriously? Just like, oh, I'm not the guy you talked to. I forwarded it to our PR department. But you get this chain, and you're like, right? Because again, I mean, media is valuable. Again, like I say, if you look at Chef and you say, well, they're giving you a 15% discount. But one of the things to be thinking about, again, like I say, with events or even with these products, is on a per unit basis, it is very inexpensive for them. right? So if you're going to do an event, and I've dealt with like tech events and all that, and I've dealt with the money of tech events, the initial outlay for that event is very expensive. So it may cost you like $50,000 to set up an event. So let's say $50,000 for 200 people to show up at an event, something like that, right? Well, here's the thing. To get zero to 200 people to get to an event, it's going to cost you $50,000. But here's the thing. To get 201 people to come to that event, it's going to cost you $50,020, right? Each additional person really actually isn't that much money, right? Because you've already got the conference rooms. You've already got the space. You've already hired the security. You've already hired the reception staff and all that kind of stuff. If you're talking about onesies, twosies, extra people, essentially all you have to do is you have to pay for a little bit more coffee and a couple of extra sandwiches. Admittedly, if you're paying a catering company, that can be surprisingly expensive, but it's really not that bad. Like if I went to the chef event, the extra cost most likely would be somewhere around $100, right? Is $100 that they're outlaying worth me talking about their product to people that will buy the product, right? That's one of the things. Even with these items that people sell, you know, so you're a startup company, but you have something like hardware, again, you're like, yeah, but this is $1,700. But the question is what does that widget actually cost, right? Because if you have to go and you have to manufacture 1,000, you know, you have a manufacturing run of 1,000 of a widget, right? So in order to do 1,000 of a widget, again, it's going to cost you $100,000 or $200,000. You know, to get 1,001 widgets, how much more is that actually going to cost you? Or do you have widgets actually sitting on the shelf that aren't being sold anyway? Like a lot of times when you do manufacturing runs, you have to do a certain amount to get manufactured. So, you know, you have to have a minimum of 1,000 of these things to get manufactured. Well, you manufacture 1,000 of these things, you sell 500 to Best Buy or Amazon.com or something like that, and you've got a whole bunch just sitting on the shelf. Now, intellectually speaking, you're like, well, Eli, each one of those units cost $50 or $100 or $500 or $1,000. But it's like right now, all it's doing is sitting on the shelf collecting dust. Is something sitting on the shelf collecting dust actually valuable? No matter how much you think you paid for it, at this point, is it actually valuable? Is it more valuable to simply ship the thing off to get reviews and talked about and be talked about in the press or media so that you can get more interest in your product? Again, that's one of the big issues that I see with people when they start thinking, and this is why I talk about money a lot. I talk about like the money mindset is you need to be thinking about money within its real context. You know, it's not a $500 ticket. It's a ticket that could be sold for $500. What's the actual cost for you? Again, that widget, it's not a $2,000 widget. It's a widget that is sitting on a shelf collecting dust right now. You know, it, along with 499 other widgets, is collecting dust. So realistically, if you ship it off and basically lose it, you lose $2,000. If that ends up helping you sell another 200 widgets or 300 widgets or 400 widgets, how much more money is that going to be? So these are the types of things that I want you guys to be thinking about. Because right now in the modern age, media, personalities, and all that kind of stuff, we are the future, and again, I would almost say the present of advertising, right? You can go out there, you can buy AdWords, you can do Facebook, you can do all that kind of stuff. But the question is how do you get in front of the people that actually care about your product? How do you get in front of your niche demographic? And if you can find the personalities, you can find the media and all that, that is talking to your niche demographic, it's very hard to specifically measure the value. It's very hard to specifically measure, you know, units sold, but it really does happen again. And it's through this process where just words and names and all that is dropped into the conversation that we are having. So that would be my thought for the day. That would be my thought, my press and media relations and all that kind of stuff. Because it is curious. It is curious in this modern world just how weird it all is, right? Again, all I hear anymore is how important, you know, YouTube and Instagram and Twitter and Facebook stars are. And then you start feeling like, yeah, we're pretty cool. And you go to some of these companies and they're like, I don't know, you're only YouTube. We'll only deal with real press. It's like, so you'll talk to the Seattle Times tech section, who probably very few people actually read because they're real press, but somebody like me, you'll blow off because we're YouTube. And again, I mean, that's the one big thing, just a simple business thing, is just realize the more difficult you make anything, the more likely it is that people will give up. And again, like I say, with the press and the media and all that, we have a lot of stuff to talk about. Again, me talking about technology, especially technology and business, there are more topics out there than I can ever get to. There are so many topics. There's so many products, there's so many services, there's so many solutions, there's just so much stuff. I just can't. Even if I wanted to get to all of it, I simply couldn't, especially they're popping out more every day. So the more difficult you make things, you know, if I'm sitting there and I'm trying to figure out what my next classes will be and I have a list of 10 things, I mean, realistically, what it is it'll be like, okay, I need to talk to the PR department or I need to get a product for this company. Go to the website, I look, if I can't find a name or a number or something in a reasonable amount of time, then that just gets slid off and I go to number two, right? And again, we're talking about a world where companies pay anywhere between one, and I've seen it all the way up to $100 per click. Like, do you want to really give up that type of advertising simply because you didn't get around to creating a press ad, whatever your company name is, .com, right? So there we go. That is the thing to think about. So now we are, what I've decided to do as far as videotaping is concerned going into the future, is the videos for Eli the Computer Guy channel will be out in nature. And then the videos for Eli Computer Guy Live channel will be in my apartment. So I've brought back the Eli Computer Guy Live channel where I do questions and comments and all that kind of stuff. And so I've been trying to figure out a good way of videotaping that, because one of the problems that I found is Seattle is a very noisy city. This is in Seattle. So what's really weird with Seattle is Seattle has a lot of nature. Seattle has a lot of nature and a lot of parks, but apparently they don't like mufflers or something. I don't know what it is. I haven't quite figured it out yet, but Seattle is a tremendously noisy, like noisy city. I don't really get what it is. And so one of the issues that I've been having is doing the Eli Computer Guy Live videos, since I do like 3 or 4 or 5 of those a day, trying to do those where I'm at in a natural setting is a real pain in the butt. There's cars and honking and all kinds of stuff. So what I decided there, since I do a lot of those videos, I'll do that inside my own apartment, just kind of like that quantity type deal. And then for these Eli the Computer Guy videos, we will keep it out here in nature, so I can actually go out and like hike 30 minutes to find a good spot to do it. I think that's weighing things well. As I like doing these Eli the Computer Guy videos in nature. And the reason is because, you know, the whole thing that I'm trying to do with all this technology and business and all that kind of stuff is I'm trying to humanize this stuff. The biggest issue that I see is with business, and especially with technology, is that it seems so inhuman. Like people just can't connect with the information. It's just they look at servers and they look at the financial systems and they look at all this stuff, and it doesn't seem human to them. So if it doesn't seem human, then how are they ever really going to learn it? How are they ever going to understand it? Again, if something seems like other, then how is it ever going, you know, how is it ever going to connect? And so what I like about doing these videos out in nature is I'm trying to bring all these concepts into that natural setting to say that, you know, technology, even servers and mobile phones and all that kind of stuff, this isn't something out there, this isn't something incomprehensible, this isn't something out there. It's just another part of the world. It's a mobile phone is as much a part of the world as that tree back there, right? So that's kind of my thought. But yeah, Seattle is a really loud city. I do have to say, I like it. There are a lot of things that I love about Seattle. Again, Seattle is a very nice place so far. Good food, good beer, good environment. Like I say, I like the people. I don't know what it is. I've got a lot of snarky comments from some of the viewers talking about Seattleites being assholes. I'm really not sure where that comes from. Maybe they can be a little aloof or something, but at least coming from Baltimore, maybe it's where you come from. The starting place you come from. But like I say, man, coming from Baltimore, I find them to be nice people. But the only thing, it really is, their traffic, I don't know what, Like, is there a different policy, or are there different regulations for like mufflers in Washington State or in Seattle? Because I just don't, you know, I lived in downtown Baltimore, and it just wasn't as loud as it is here in Seattle. I think one of the things that I've noticed in Seattle is they have much bigger trucks going through more residential type areas, and their buses. So in Baltimore, there's a lot of streets where basically only, you know, like normal cars go down, you know, so normal cars and normal trucks. Around here, there's a lot of these big, like, diesel trucks, you know, these types of trucks that that haul water, or they haul septic tanks, or they haul fuel oil, that kind of stuff. And so maybe it's that those trucks are on the road, or the buses, too, are much louder than they are in Baltimore. But it's a very loud city. I do have to say, that is the one... So far, my you know, time being here, the one downside I'll say to Seattle is loud. Don't know why, but it is true. So if you're planning to do videos in Seattle, just realize it's kind of hard to find a nice quiet place. But when you do find a nice quiet place, you get this. And again, like I said, I'm actually in the city right now. So I live in Green Lake area. And so this isn't Green Lake, this is Riviera Park, I don't know. But like literally, I just walked from my apartment for about 15 minutes and got here. And like this is in downtown. They've got a lot, and they've got a lot of waterfront, they've got a lot of nice parks, a lot of nice stuff. So yeah, there we go. That's my whole thing on media and press. It's so weird, it's so funny. It's like, come on guys, come on. I just don't, it's just so funny to deal with some companies. It's just like so, like, yeah. So, yeah, that's a final thought, like I say, with media and press, is whatever your company is, especially if you're going to be dealing with, like, people, if you need press, if you need advertising and all that, simply come up with a press policy. And again, with this, like I say, like with CES, I'm not even saying that they should necessarily include me. But when they say that YouTubers should not even apply, like, come up with that threshold, right, in the modern world. Is it 100,000 subscribers for a YouTuber? Is it 500,000 subscribers for a YouTuber? Is it 1 million subscribers for YouTube? Like, if I went to the CES website and they said we require a YouTuber to have 1 million subscribers before they can do press pass, I mean, yes, I will have a little tantrum, but I can understand that. It's like, okay. I'm kind of whiny, but I get that. But when they kind of they make a blanket statement about YouTuber, then it's like, you know, you are a consumer electronics show. You're supposed to be like, I'm not saying you're at the bleeding edge or even at the cutting edge, but you should be somewhere around the cusp of what's going on in technology. You know what I'm saying? But anyways, at this point, I'm just probably talking about a lot of nothing. So with that, we'll call it a day, and we'll see you at the next video.
I think that's going to be an issue.
Actually, very HVAC, so.